Would you please join me in welcoming Paul Gilding?
I can't think of any more important task in the world, really, than environmental education in terms of the long-term future of our civilization and society. So it's a great pleasure to be talking to you today, and hopefully we can have a good conversation. I'm going to speak for about half an hour or so, and then I'm going to throw it open to questions because I'm really keen to hear from you about how you see these issues, and perhaps I can, you know, help answer some of these big questions about optimism, pessimism, and despair, where the world's going, will we make it, etc., which is what I want to cover with you today. This is a great conference. I was very pleased to meet David Orr here, whose work I've known for a long time and quoted in my book, and have been a great admirer of his work over the years. So you've done very well to get him here. Costa yesterday, as I understand it, who in my life has been very important because he refereed my kids' rugby matches in Sydney. Apparently he works in the environment as well. No, seriously. Great motivator, inspirer, and obviously this is the focus of my comments to you today, is really about this issue of, you know, where are we going? Will we get there? Is this something we can feel good about? There's a lot of despair and worry about these issues, which there correctly should be for reasons I'll go through. But there's also great reason for hope and great reason for optimism about where we end up in this process and the opportunity before us. So that's really kind of the broad view of my comments to you today. Maybe in opening, I'll start off just explaining a bit of more about my background. Hopefully you can understand me speaking this fast. I just came back from Brazil yesterday, where I had to put on my Brazilian speaking voice, which is a lot slower than this normally. And hopefully, just raise your hands if I get too excited. Look, I've worked on this issue for nearly four decades. I started off as an activist at the age of 15. Some of the people you're working with in that kind of age group, and really felt very motivated by just making the world a different and better place. And it was very interesting. People often ask, why did you go down that path? I really have no idea. I just felt called and sort of inspired by the idea of making a difference. So I spent my kind of 14, 15, 16-year-old period wondering about the world, engaging in activism, anti-apartheid activism in particular, during that period, Aboriginal land rights. In Northern Australia, lived with an Aboriginal community in far north Queensland, really kind of explored this whole issue. And the interesting thing for me at that time was I started off on frankly, in hindsight, embarrassingly silly issues like, could I wear school uniform or not? Could I wear my hair long? The issues that were really important to 14, 15-year-olds, and then discovered the anti-apartheid issue. And in the mid-70s, recognising that young people at my age were dying for their beliefs in South Africa around the massacre at Soweto in particular, really kind of woke me up, if you like, to how serious the issues can be and how lucky we are in Australia to be in the position we are and the opportunities that we have. And that really kind of seared in my memory, I guess, the good fortune that I had and the good fortune that we all have living here to make a difference. I went through a kind of long period of two decades in activism, human rights, environmental issues, nuclear weapons issues, working on the Save Jervis Bay campaign, on campaigns against visits by nuclear armed warships into Australia, working eventually during that time towards more pure environmental issues, ended up working with Greenpeace Australia, first of all as a toxics campaign coordinator, which was a really, you know, sort of defining period of my life because it was the time when environmental issues were really coming onto the agenda in the late 80s, early 90s, really kind of woke up the country as to how important these issues were. And the work we did at Greenpeace at that time was, as my introduction talks about, plugging up discharge pipes of large industrial companies confronting pollution at source. And really, that was, again, just on an emotional level, incredibly empowering. You know, the sense that you were doing something, making a difference, exposing the world to what was happening, bringing that pollution and those problems onto the TV screens of the country and confronting those who were behaving in that way. It should be said at that time that I was really enjoying the black and whiteness of life. It was pretty simple. I was right, they were wrong. I had righteousness on my side. They were doing evil things and we were able to stop them. And that was, I guess, you know, the reason I say it in that kind of slightly flippant way is because I also look back on that period thinking that's really not as simple as, it's not quite like that, is it? And that sense of obligation that we all have to look inside as to why we're doing things. And I think that started for me at Greenpeace Australia after doing that kind of work and taking great pleasure in that you know, because in activism, you have to communicate things in that simple way, right? You really have to get across, this is wrong, you know, therefore we're kind of putting ourselves forward as being right. The people who are doing it are wrong. And that's very effective in that way. I mean, it's no question that really puts things on the front page of the paper. You know, we were kind of flooded with media coverage at the time and being very effective in that work. But there was this inkling in me about the kind of what was behind that and the ethical kind of moral personal issues about how we treat each other and how we think about each other in that context. And what became clear to me while I was still at Greenpeace Australia doing that work before I moved on to Greenpeace International was that, you know, idea of us as humans and where we end up and why and what we're doing. And the importance, which I kind of take Nelson Mandela as my kind of sort of guide on these sort of issues philosophically, is to separate the behaviour from the people. And it was really critical to me at that stage, recognising that there were people in the corporate sector who were, you know, there for whatever sort of historical reasons doing these things and were struggling as I was with how we change and what we should do differently. And that really started a journey for me about the role of the market and the role of ideology and the importance of being keeping an open mind to how we do things, who does them and how we treat each other in this grand process of trying to make civilization a better place to be. I became the head of Greenpeace Australia. Soon after that, became the head of Greenpeace International. So I, having previously spent some time in the Air Force, that was this kind of ultimate revenge for me to have my own Navy, which was particularly interesting. And really, for a young Australian, suddenly catapulted into being the head of Greenpeace worldwide was an extraordinary experience. I was obviously very young, too young, too naive to do it. The head of Greenpeace Germany at the time, a very intensely political organisation and interesting kind of relationships between different national offices. I mean, think about a global NGO, many more now, but at that time, 30 countries is really kind of a mini United Nations. And everyone behaved pretty much in line with their stereotype. We Australians were loud and brash and arrogant and thought we had the answers to everything, but always friendly. The Germans were highly organised, incredibly effective, highly efficient and rich, et cetera, et cetera. And I could go through the rest of them, but I won't because I'll insult half of you in the room probably. But the point of the head of the German office came to me at one stage when I was in the running for being the global head of Greenpeace and said, well, Paul, we the German office have spoken about this, and she said, we've had a very serious conversation, and we decided that you're clearly too young, too inexperienced, and too naive to do this job, and we're going to support you because otherwise, anybody who wasn't young, naive, and silly wouldn't do the job in the first place because it's impossible as an organisation to run. So therefore, we're supporting your candidacy. I think that's thank you, but I'm not really sure. So the point of that story is that, you know, the idea of environmentalism is relatively new, right? And the idea of a global NGO that we pay $50, you know, a year to support and go and break the law for us and do things that we wouldn't like to really do ourselves but would like to be done was and is a radical idea, right? And I think kind of giving ourselves a little bit of comfort that we're working this out as we're going along is actually not a bad way to think about it. But this is really new, it is really unusual. And the fact that we have to think collectively as a society, as a people, as a civilization globally for the first time is really a remarkable idea and a very new thing within human history. So, you know, fast forwarding the story, became head of Greenpeace International, really pushed this idea that we should not be anti-corporate or anti-anything apart from anti-behaviour, which is damaging to the environment, was now pretty much accepted by every major NGO like that. And most NGOs work with business and work with foundations and work with all sorts of people to try and get the job done. But at the time, it was very unpopular, very, not unpopular, it was very controversial, I should say, inside Greenpeace, that we were really struggling with this thing of what was the role of the organisation vis-a-vis the corporate sector and markets and how do you drive change, the role of government and so on. So that was really a very important time for the organisation, for the movement, I think, and back to this issue of who we are and how we fit in terms of what's right and what's wrong, you know, what institutional structures we have to engage with on what basis, I think, is a really important issue for, certainly for all of your work, in my opinion, that we think about that, you know, that broader context. I left Greenpeace in the mid-90s and I went into business, which was very unusual for most of my friends in Greenpeace, who thought immediately, okay, he's sold out and gone to the corporate sector, he's gone, you know, going for the money kind of thing, despite the fact that I've been arguing this for a long time. I had to look inside myself at that stage and ask the deep questions, okay, why am I doing this? is this genuinely because I believe, as I did, and I think I did, and I reflect and think I was right, that there is a job to do engaging large businesses and corporations on this issue? Or am I being driven by ego? Am I driven by, you know, anger? What are the kind of internal drivers for my life that are on the sort of guiding this behaviour? Because when all of your friends think you've gone to the dark side, it's quite personally challenging. Right? So I had to really ask that question of myself regularly, and did so regularly for the next sort of 10 years or so. And over time, I think, came to prove that there was a role, not that it was the right thing to do, but it was a thing to do that was useful to engage in that way. And many of my friends who thought ill of me at the time have become back in the fold and are good friends again, which I'm pleased to say, because that's personally quite challenging. You know. And I think sometimes when you're at the edge of an idea, as many of you are, in society, in your institutions, then it can be quite challenging to stay focused and stay believing in what you're doing in the face of people around you criticising it. And that's, I think, really important historical reality of environmentalism as well. So I went from there into working in the corporate sector quite intensely. So with a small business of 20 professional staff based around the world, doing work with large companies like DuPont and Ford, BHP, Billiton, Insurance Australia Group, you know, all sorts of different companies in different sectors, trying to understand how these issues translate into business. How do we get businesses to think about these issues, not just as moral issues, which they clearly are, but also as sort of social, economic framing of the market. You know? So how do we think about these issues as framing ideas around the future of business? And that's an interpretation thing, which you also do, of course, all the time. How do you interpret this global context into a useful way for people you're working with? So I did that for 15 years or so, and now, just to finish the personal story, and I'll come back to why I'm telling you all that in a moment, ended up leaving that, and now I've, you know, written books in the area, write a lot, speak a lot, work with a few companies, but primarily try and think about the global system. I think about the global system and where we're going, because that's my chosen activity right now in terms of how I can contribute the best of the issue, is to think about the context, right, in which we're doing this, because we're all so busy doing our things in the area, which is absolutely important and critical work, that I think it's important for some of us to sit back and reflect on that bigger context. So I do that at the University of Cambridge, where I'm a visiting fellow, as I say, writing, speaking, working with all sorts of interesting people in foundations that fund campaigns in the area, the military in a variety of countries, which is an interesting new area for me, thinking about this issue of issues of risk and global instability. Still working with a number of companies like Unilever in the UK and others. So the reason I say all that is to give you, you know, it's nice to know who's talking to you, but also it's important to think about what I'm about to say, given that history. So I do approach these issues from the point of view of being an environmentalist, of being a human rights advocate, of being a corporate advisor, of being in business, of being a university fellow, of being an advisor to the military, of trying to think all these things and think of that system as a whole. And I think it's important, as I said, to really think about these issues in that broader context when we're doing this work. So let me kind of go to reflecting a bit on the big broad sweep of civilization's flow, if you like, through environmental issues and where that sits. I think briefly we have to start off with Rachel Carson and Silent Spring. If we go back 50 years and think about the birth of environmentalism, think about these issues in the way we think about them now, which is that we're in the environment, that we're part of the environment, that we're working on protecting our system, not something over there, is again a relatively new idea. When Rachel Carson wrote Silent Spring in the 60s, she was an author of fiction books as well as being a great scientist. She said radical things for the time, like that, you know, we're behaving like this is the age of the mind of Neanderthal man that thinks, you know, we are separate from the environment as opposed to being part of the environment, focusing on pesticide use and so on. And that was a radical thought at the time. She got vilified, attacked. You know, if you look at the attacks on her, there's a whole bunch of sexism in there about she's hysterical, she's overreacting, etc. One of the most fascinating things I found writing my book, looking at Rachel Carson's work, is that one of the major companies that was attacking her was Monsanto, which is just goes to show that, you know, things don't change that much. And that was interesting as well about that, the way people responded to that then and the way they have since and how many similarities there are to how we respond to those things. But, you know, 50 years ago, talking about that, the limits to growth in the early 70s, talking about, you know, the fact that there are inherent limits to an infinite growth economy. Now, These ideas really frame the next decades of activism, scientific research, thought, corporate arguments, policy, etc., in this area, which is the idea that if we don't change, the future is going to suffer, right? Our children's children will suffer the consequences of our behaviour if we don't do things differently. And I guess the trying to think about how to explain this in big, broad sweep and very simple idea is that for 50 years, we've been arguing if we don't change, our children's children are going to suffer. Well, you know, guess what? We're their children's children. I mean, this is the point where the consequences come home to roost in terms of that behaviour not changing all that time ago and all throughout since. So we are at the point of consequence. We're at the point where there is going to be, or there are today, I would argue, a major global crisis unfolding around us around the consequences of this environmental and social misbehaviour, for want of a better term. And by the way, as I go through this and sort of take you into the depths of how bad the situation is, don't worry, I will bring you back out again. But we kind of have to go there. And I think that we struggle in this issue, and the big struggle I had writing The Great Disruption was this argument that, look, we mustn't be despair-inducing, we mustn't be negative, we mustn't talk about doom and gloom because people get disempowered by that. All true. No one wants to hear that stuff, right? My response is yes, but if we all only talk about the opportunity and how cool it is and how great it's going to be as we build a better world, people's response is, oh, that's good, I don't have to worry about it anymore. So there's this sort of tension, if you like, in the psychology of us and a system whereby I think we have to go to how bad it is and then have to go to how good it can be and talk about that transition. And my optimism comes from an honest appraisal of our situation. I think it's very important we go there. So I'm taking it there today. Let's just think about the basic idea that we've got an economy currently using about 150% of the Earth's capacity. Now, that's not a kind of rhetorical line. It is actually a very good rhetorical line. But it's not only a rhetorical line. It's a scientific fact that we are using resources much faster than they can be replenished. Now, that means our economy is fundamentally unsustainable. And when people think of things as being unsustainable versus sustainable, they tend to think of things as being, well, sustainability would be better, wouldn't it? It'd be kind of nicer. It'd be nicer for polar bears, it'd be nicer for trees, it'd be a nicer place to be, it would just be a nicer life. And all true, but the essence of my argument is not that. The essence of my argument is that things that are unsustainable stop. And we kind of forget that that's a physical thing. That when people say our economy is unsustainable, what it means is if we don't change, our economy will stop. Right? And that means our society will stop developing, stop progressing, stop advancing, because the model we have of growth is unsustainable, and that's a really critical idea. So if we're operating today at 150% of capacity, let's think about the aspiration of society, and just having been in Brazil this week and come back yesterday, you know, they are very focused on this idea of rapid growth economy because they have incredible poverty and need to alleviate their poverty, and that's the model they've got for doing so. Right, is that we are determined as a society to grow the economy from where it is today at 150% of capacity, the system capacity, by another 300% per capita. Right, so we plan to go from 1.5 Earths multiplied by 300% just for consumption per capita, nothing to do with population. Right, so just consumption per capita. So therefore, we plan to drive the system into complete overload. Plus, of course, the much lesser issue, I think, of population growth being an extra 30% from that. But 30% more from population growth in terms of impact, 300% more impact in terms of you know, per capita consumption. So the point of that is that that's not possible. Right? The point of that is not that I'm telling you the world's going to be horrible and this is going to happen and everything will fall apart. My point of that is our model of progress doesn't work anymore. Right, the very essence of our idea of where we're going as a society, how we alleviate poverty, how we get progress, etc., isn't physically possible. And that economic problem is how I describe this to companies. It's like you might want to grow, right? You might think it's important to grow. This is not a philosophical question. The question is, how do we possibly grow a system that far beyond its capacity? Because the answer is it won't, right? The answer is that we're going to be forced to change. And then, you know, the obvious question is like, oh, why aren't we changing? If it's that urgent, why aren't we changing? And then my response is really to look at back inside people and say, oh, how do we behave as a species? And the answer is we tend to, very consistently, in every situation where we face serious threat, personal health, organisational, you know, bankruptcy, World War II, pick any kind of example of big major threats, and we always behave pretty much the same way, which is that we talk about, think about, argue about this nature of the threat. We argue about our ability to respond or not to respond. We all agree in the end that it's really, really urgent that we really, really should do something. And we wait until the last possible moment when if we don't change, it's going to be a complete catastrophe. And then right at that last moment, we stop and we think about it a bit longer. And then we wait a bit longer and then we panic and respond. Right? And that's, I think, you know, I'm obviously simplifying things a little bit, but that's exactly how we always do this stuff. You know, and World War II, I think, is perhaps the best example of this kind of on steroids, which is that, you know, we had the same arguments before World War II in the UK, which were, look, yeah, no, it's a serious threat, but it's not that serious, and we mustn't overreact, and we can't really afford to react, and the reaction will be worse than the problem, and it isn't that bad anyway, and maybe we should think about it a bit more, and there must be another way of doing this, and I really don't want to change, and we can't afford to, and it's all too much, and da-da-da-da, and then, hallelujah, we finally woke up to the size of the problem and reacted. And that I think, is really critical to understand. That's the pattern of behaviour, and that's, I think, the pattern of behaviour on this issue, which is that we're waiting, we're kind of just past midnight now, and we're kind of waiting to the last possible minute, and then we're going to respond. And my argument would be that's not like a, you know, on November the 4th, 2018, we're going to wake up one day and suddenly respond. It's obviously a trend I'm talking about, but I think it's a rapid change. And I would argue that not only is how we're going to change, it's how we are already changing. And I would argue that what we see looking around today, if we sit back and look at it as I do, that we're seeing that crisis unfold, we're seeing the consequences hit home hard, and we're seeing the response in very significant ways. Now, the response, the crisis, if you like, that we're seeing today is really around us everywhere. And we look back on this and say, that was obvious that was happening then. I mean, first of all, the economy is not growing as well as it used to be. Now, is that because of New York investment cowboys designing bad credit products? Is it because oil prices went through the roof? Is it because we've had two major global food crises, which has then triggered great inequality and a lot of political instability, which then damages the economy? That kind of idea. Is it caused by, we never know which particular argument we can make about what a cause of a particular situation is, but we can look at the system and say the system can't carry on like this because the levels of inequality, right, the levels of climate change consequence, the levels of energy problems we're having around the world and the political instability that all causes are really grinding us to a halt as a society. People know, and this is very interesting, I think, for you to hear, I don't talk to every company, obviously, but I don't talk to any companies now, and I talk to a lot of companies, right, who are in denial about the problem, right? That wasn't the case 5 years ago. 5 years ago, I was having very serious conversations about the basic science and what the evidence was. I don't have those conversations anymore. I don't have them in oil companies. I don't have them in coal companies. I don't talk to the Koch brothers and a few wackos out there. But by and large, I talk to a lot of varieties of businesses, and there is very little denial about the fundamental problem. The argument is timing. You know, how long have we got? Can we afford to respond? What does it mean for me? So that's really important, right? Because we've now got a situation where we have the heads of state of virtually every country in the world, the heads of most companies in the world, certainly the vast majority of the population all saying, yep, we've got a problem, we should do something. And that's really not to be underestimated, because that wasn't like that in the 70s and 80s. It wasn't like it in the 90s. Right, so we are now in a very different stage where we have basic acceptance of the need to act, and that's a very big change. Perhaps most encouragingly from my point of view is that we're now seeing quite strong responses inside the market. So when I talk to business people about this and investors, they say, well, that's right, then why aren't we seeing evidence of that? If this massive economic change is coming underway, given that we believe in market forces, and this is talking to business people, we believe in market forces, we believe that markets are fundamentally intelligent and sort of self-organising as a system, then wouldn't we see a response? And I say, well, open your eyes and look and you'll see it. So one of them, which I think is getting a lot of impact in other countries but is sort of being ignored here, is the demise of the coal industry. The coal industry is finished. Right? Now, it's not just finished because it's a bad thing to do and it's bad for the climate change, it's finished economically. And its decline is now inevitable. And the market has woken up to that. So, for example, the average price of a pure coal company in the world, if you look at a measure like the Bloomberg Coal Index, the average valuation of coal companies globally has gone down by 2/3 in the last 4 years. So if the value of your house went down by 2/3 in 4 years, I think you'd be paying attention. Now, they think it's going to magically come back, and it's not. So the market is speaking that is happening, that's now underway. Think about the car industry. So I worked with Ford Motor Company many years ago, so I know a lot about the car industry, and to think about them as sort of market machines, if you like, or market mechanisms for change. You know, the Tesla, which is the exciting new electric car company out of the US that a lot of people are talking about in this space. Tesla last year produced 30,000 cars. That's not many cars. General Motors last year produced 9 million cars. That's a lot of cars. Right, just in case some of you aren't mathematically inclined as teachers here, 30,000 is a lot less than 9 million. So you would expect the valuation of a Tesla electric car company, the market cap, the value of the whole company, to be a lot less than GM, which of course it is. But you'd think it would be infinitesimally small by comparison. You would think it would be irrelevant in market terms compared to a mighty GM. Now, what's good for America is good for GM, and vice versa was a slogan for many years. Tesla today, with its 30,000 cars, is valued by the market at more than half of GM, which is amazing. I mean, it's like worth $28 billion last time I looked versus GM being worth about 50. So the market is saying, okay, well, I'm not sure which way this is going, but I think fundamentally this is the future. You've got it and you've worked it out. You are the past and you're in decline, right? And you're not going to work it out. Now, why is it that someone like GM, with all of its technology, all of its R&D, all of its incredible history and understanding of the global auto market, can't work it out that the future is electric, or at least non-fossil fuels, and Tesla can, right, is the nature of markets. That's not a judgment on GM's morality or ethics, it's just a reality of how markets work, as we tend to replace old companies with new companies. And my message to you today is that that's already underway, right? That we're seeing, for example, in the solar industry, incredible growth, 30, 40% a year in the growth in the coal industry. Then in the solar industry, matched by the decline of the coal industry. Incredible drops in valuation. So we're seeing the cost, for example, of producing solar panels has gone down by 80% in 4 years. Now, when I say that to people in business, imagine if your competitor's cost base went down by 80% in 4 years and yours didn't. You know, they understand, okay, that means that game's over. This is the new game. So we're in denial about this happening in the market, and coal is not good for humanity, despite what you might have heard recently from some of our political leaders. And the market has woken up to that reality, right? The market has woken up and said, actually, I don't care if it's good for humanity or not, because most people in the marketplace are not immoral, they're amoral. They just don't care very much. They don't think about it very much, right? They're not worried about it. They're very happy to get rich on the back of solar and electric cars. They don't really care how they make money. And that's, at last, playing to our favour. Right, because even though many companies are resisting the change because they see themselves correctly as part of the past, the people who invest in these things and allocate money and buy companies are saying, I don't really care which way we go as long as I know what way it is so I can be part of that future. And that transition is now underway. Another example of this, which I think is incredibly powerful in Australia, and one thing that I would advocate very strongly is one of the most important things that we all need to do, is the arrival of solar on rooftops. Now, rooftop solar in Australia has gone from 8,000 homes, I think it was 5 years ago, to 1.3 million today. Now, that started off because of strong government subsidies and support for the second 8,000, and then quickly got wound back because, according to governments around the country, we were getting too much solar. I mean, how the hell are you going to have too much solar is beyond me as a concept. We've got too much renewable energy. That's a terrible thing. We should go back to burning shit. That's really much better. So that kind of whole mentality is bizarre, but that's what governments have done, and therefore they've wound it back. And in Queensland in particular, where it just keeps on booming, they've got it back from, you know, instead of being paid 27 cents per kilowatt hour for every bit of power, every kilowatt hour you export back to the grid, you now get paid sort of 8 cents, I think it is, or maybe 6 cents in some states, and then you pay 27 to pull it back out again. Right? So they're punishing people who do solar now. Punishing people who do solar and saying, stop doing so much solar, we've got too much of this clean, bloody energy. So what are people doing in response to that? They're putting in more and more solar, right? Because the utilities, they really get annoyed by the fact that they're now being punished for doing solar. They like the fact that all their friends are doing it. There's a thing called the solar avalanche where you get to 50% of installed solar in a suburb, which takes a long time, and then suddenly go from 50 to 90%. because everyone else is saying, well, why are they doing it? I'm not. What's their story? And of course, everyone you talk to about it says, oh, I think it's great. I've got a negative power bill. I'm making more solar, more power this month than I did last month, and I track it every month, and it's really cool and exciting and fun. So it's not economic anymore in the sense of, is it a good financial return? It's a question of, it makes me feel good. I really like making my own energy. I really like thinking about the fact that I'm part of the solution. And that is a very powerful psychological, social phenomena, which is now driving an increasing rate of installations in Queensland in particular, where air conditioning is now being paid for by solar in terms of the power generation. The utilities are losing lots of money. And their solution to it, as any good business would be, we're getting paid less money for what we used to do, so we'll put the price up. Right? And of course, if you're thinking about putting solar, the more you put the price up, the more you install solar. And of course, the more you install solar, the more they put the price up. So guess where they're going? Right, it's called the death spiral of the utility sector globally. This is a phenomena where people are taking charge of their future and people are putting in their own solar panels and feeling really good about it, feeling really good about the distributed nature of that system. And the utilities, you know, which again are not bad people. I don't want to make this sound as though they're kind of devil companies. They're not. They're just nice people, smart people who are trying to do the right thing in their jobs, in their role, and can't see the future because they're so wedded to the past. Right, so they can't imagine what that transformation looks like, and they can't see how dramatically exciting and transformational that is and what they do about it. So that's where they kind of are today. So if you look at that in energy, you know, you've got coal in decline, solar in boom, electric cars in boom, et cetera, and then you can look at that as we do and as I often do as a great kind of moral, you know, political, social issue, which it is, absolutely is, very clearly. You can also look at it as just like, we've just got a better idea now. We thought about this, and we thought about doing things inefficiently, dirtily, in ways that damages human health and is bad for our economy. And then we had this alternative idea, which is actually just a better, smarter idea that's cleaner, cheaper, and more sustainable. And we think that's a better idea, and we'll go and do that now. And that transition, if you like, which we painted as this great moral challenge, which, as I said, make sure I'm clear about this, it is, right, is also just an economic transformation. It's a different way of doing things in our society, and the market is now accelerating that process, and that's where I think we kind of are at today, is this, in this change process. So that then, you know, of course, raises the bigger issue. So why can't we see that? Why do we not hear our political leaders talking about this in this way? And this is not, you know, even though we get a bit annoyed in this area with the Abbott government's attitude in this issue, this is not unusual. Right, countries go backwards and forwards on this issue over time. We come good, we go bad, we all have bad days. America's having a particularly bad day at the moment in terms of this issue. But nevertheless, in California, incredible rates of installation. That's where Tesla, the electric car company, is. That's where solar is going through the roof. And it's where we have people who are doing some of the most exciting things in the world in this area. So the point of that is don't get confused by the daily conversation about it or the politics of it. Think about the fundamental things that are going on underneath. The final set of comments I want to make, and then I'm going to throw it open to questions, is really about, you know, so my point is that we're going to fix climate change. It's going to get ugly. It's going to get messier before it gets better. The transition is difficult because there's a big scientific lag in the system of driving change, but we're going to fix it. We're going to fix it when we wake up and do things much faster. We'll do it through economic change. We'll do it through dramatically different companies beating old companies and replacing them. But in the end, having the whole world powered on renewable energy isn't enough, right? Because you can't fundamentally have 7 or 9 billion people shopping like we shop, you know, buying like we buy things. And when I talk about this idea and focus, you know, on the potential for ideas like the collapse of civilization and the end of shopping, people are much more focused on the end of shopping than they are on the collapse of civilization, which apparently for a lot of people is a lot scarier than the collapse of civilization. So let me talk to you about the end of shopping. Now, the end of shopping is really, I think, the biggest idea around. And I don't mean it literally, of course, in the end of shopping. What I mean is the idea that we should define our human progress, our satisfaction and our meaning through buying stuff. Now, this is not a new idea. This has been around for many, many decades. But the point is now is not only, this is no longer a philosophical question, it's now a practical question, as the Chinese government is finding out, that you can't behave in an old industrial economy, consumption-based model, which is based around material stuff, right, and grow that fast and not have a problem. Right? And that is where we are today, is that we are not going to be able to progress civilization to its next level of development in this way. Not because it's not good for us, not because it's not right, not because it's bad for the world, although it is all those things, but because it's not possible. So therefore, we, I think, and in particular, I talk to you in your role, we've got to start thinking about that in the future. We've got to start thinking, what does that look like? How can we possibly, because we can't all keep on getting richer forever, right? There is, I mean, not that the money causes us any damage, but we don't tend to just put it in the bank. We tend to buy stuff with it, right? And if we all do that, and there's 9 billion of us doing that, an extra billion plus middle-class consumers by the end of this decade doing that, it's just not going to work. So we're going to change. And I think we have to start asking the question, what does that look like? Now, is it possible to alleviate poverty with the number of resources we have in the world? Is it possible to be happier every year? Can you develop a society in that way without economic growth? Right? Is it possible to think about a world where we actually progress because we just get smarter and happier and more secure and more advanced, as opposed to getting richer with bigger cars, bigger houses, and having, you know, a car with a bowling alley in the back? That kind of idea, I think, is where we are today. We have to start thinking about that very deeply, and particularly for young people. So people, you know, ask me, okay, what's the most important thing I can do about the environmental issue at a personal community level? And my answer is always the same. It's not, you know, cut your emissions or, you know, use less paper or whatever. It's not that those things are bad. It's that you should buy less stuff. Right? And this is a really kind of challenging idea because it's so simple but so profound, the idea of buying less stuff. And I don't mean, and again, I say this argument not as a moral thing, you should buy less stuff because you're being bad. You should buy less stuff and see what it feels like. Just see what it feels like. So, you know, we, on a personal level, if you get less focused on consumption, you start to wonder, okay, so I really want to have that thing. And yeah, we all buy things. We all have our weaknesses. Mine's hardware shops. I go into a hardware shop, I buy tools, I'm a much better tradesman immediately because I have a better tool. My wife convinces me it's had no impact at all. I'm still completely useless around the house. But, you know, I still love going out. I mean, my 40th birthday many years ago now, my present was the whole family walked around every aisle of the hardware shop with me. And they wouldn't leave until I'd had enough. And they thought it won't last long. And they were surprised how long it lasted. So this is not something I want to paint as this great evil thing. It's just this idea that we should challenge ourselves. Why are we doing this? You know, are we happier for doing this? In Australia, UK, most Western countries, we've doubled the per capita income, right, in the last 30 years. The evidence says we're no happier. We're no more satisfied. We don't think our quality of life has improved, right? But we've doubled the size of our economy. And we're completely obsessed about doing that again and again and again. And it doesn't work. It absolutely works if you're in poverty, don't get me wrong. If you're in grinding poverty, being richer is really beneficial, right? Because it's about food and housing and education, security, the things that really matter. But for us, it makes no difference anymore. Individually, we move ahead, we make more money, we feel better inside because we're doing better than our colleagues are or the person down the street, right? So it does have an impact, but it doesn't have an impact on the society as a whole. So we're kind of just churning around inside, changing places, changing positions, right? As opposed to actually progressing as a society. And the education task, in my view, the policy task is to improve the society as a whole, and we're not getting there in the current model. So that's why I think this idea of who are we, how do we progress as a civilization, what does our future look like, is fundamentally an optimistic idea. Famous writer from North America, where they're all smarter than we are, David Orr, once wrote, if I hope I get this right now that you're here, no, hope is a verb with its sleeves rolled up. So hope is not kind of an idea that we should be hopeful because it makes us feel better. Hope is an active idea, right? It's a deliberate intervention in our lives, in the system, saying we can do this, right? So it's not an optimistic view of the world. It's a deliberate decision that we can drive change faster and better if we can project optimism, if we can project belief of what's possible. And that is a very infectious idea. It's an infectious idea that actually gets things done. And closing, quoting again from Nelson Mandela, it always seems impossible until it's done. Right? There's this idea that we can make a difference if we choose to. And there's no great social movements in history that have been driven with the idea that we're probably stuffed, but we'll have a go on the way down. It's like the idea is I have a dream. ANC's slogan in South Africa was freedom in our lifetime. It was that belief that we can make a difference, that the world future is going to be better, is a powerful way of mobilising our hearts and our souls to the task that we have before us. So thank you very much.
Hi, just at the back here, Angela Colliver from the Primary Industries Education Foundation. What do you think the new game is going to be, or is now, in the realm of food? You talked about solar and energy, etc. What about food?
Yeah, I think I really like food. I really like food as an issue, because food, it's so deep as an idea. It's so fundamental to who we are. It's how we connect. It's how we relate. I just started a new blog with my sons, one of whom's an IT person and photographer, one of whom's a chef, Asher Gilding, who'll be feeding you tomorrow night, called Green Apple Isle. And it's the idea of, you know, can we kind of connect in our society via food? So I think that's sort of part of the story on food, is that food is so fundamental to our society. It's how we talk. It's how we... our culture is often defined by that relationship. The growing of it, the consumption of it, and the connections that it makes in our society is very important. So there's that local aspect of it, which I think is really important. The second thing is that it synthesises and explains to us what all this global complexity looks like. So if you've got climate change, degraded aquifers, political conflict, you know, speculation in the food system, all these sort of issues around GMOs and chemical use, et cetera, et cetera, the result is food. So that the way that we can think about the global context is food. And I think if there's one thing that worries me more than anything else in terms of its ability to trigger, you know, global economic negative trends, it's food. And so I think, again, a bit like the solar argument, it's not hard to fix, right? We just got to decide to fix it. It's not, we've got enough food in the world. We've got enough capacity to produce enough food in the world, not to all eat, you know, perhaps everything we'd like, we think we want to eat in terms of meat and dairy and so on. But I do think that we have enough capacity to feed the world comfortably, and we have to just decide to respond to that. But that's getting a lot of attention now, because it is the synthesis of these global issues into a very sharp focus. And I think we're going to see a lot of food crises in the coming years. And remember, a food crisis is not enough food. When we see this happening, remember, it's not enough food, right? It's a question of food prices. Can we produce food at the right price and get it in the right place at the right time is the issue in the global food system, not the capacity. So when we talk about the need to increase capacity, yes, that's an issue, but it's much more important. It's how we produce it, where we produce it, how local is it, and do we have resilience in our societies as a system? That's the question. Yeah.
Paul, thank you very much for your talk. David Walker from the Gould League. A couple of points you made. Firstly, you said that all the companies you speak to are facing up to the reality and are preparing to change. Yet it seems that their lobbying of government is that, no, there's no need for change. Is that just rent-seeking and making sure they can make as much money in the meantime before they do change? Or what? That's the first question. The second one was you talked about how important it is to lift people out of poverty, and we don't suffer it here, so we can probably take a step back. Are there enough resources in the world in terms of the 150% consumption? Are there enough resources there to actually get people out of poverty so that we can all live a reasonable life?
Yeah, look, good questions. The first one, the answer is yes. They're rent-seeking. So the bottom line is that what I'm saying is they're not accepting the scale of change that we need to go through in terms of speed, but they're not denying the underlying causes of the problem. So when I say I'm not hearing denial anymore, what I'm not hearing is this is not a problem, we don't have to address it, you're overstating the seriousness of it. What I'm hearing is very serious problem, agree we need to change, can we do it after I've left my job, please? Right, so it's just a personal kind of, I do judge them harshly. I shouldn't say that. I'd like to not judge them as harshly as I do, but you know, which I try not to judge them harshly because they're doing what they do, right? Which is we all defend our turf and our job. We have certain roles in society. Our job is to stop them. Right? Our job is to stop companies doing things they shouldn't do through regulations, through public pressure, through buying patterns, and so on. So I think the system works. You know, markets work because we control them. They don't work in isolation. They work as regulation and public attitudes guides them towards a certain outcome. So I think that's an important point. Yes, we have enough resources for a decent quality of life for 9 billion people. Absolutely, clearly. Now, that requires radical change in how we do things. It requires change in how much stuff we think we need, and it requires changes in models towards sharing, right? I mean, physical, you know, sharing models around cars and bicycles and various things. It requires the internet and digital technology to do an amazing job of connecting people and making things possible. I mean, just things like Airbnb, right? So people have a spare room, they rent it out to someone to stay in. That's a more efficient use of resources. In those ways, at large scale, we can do a lot of these things that we need to do with the current models of society. When people worry about resources, they assume that we're going to double or triple the size of the economy indefinitely. That's not possible. And that's when we have a resource constraint. If we recognise we need to do things differently, like just a very simple example, I was with Unilever last week in Brazil and talking to them about the waste issue. Well, there's a massive waste issue in rapidly growing economies like Brazil that don't have the capacity to recycle and produce that stuff in the right way. Amazing opportunity for them. Now, that you simply have to do a circular economy. Right? So everything you produce, every single piece of packaging has to come back and get recycled. So put a deposit on it. Right? Put 10 cents on every container and every container will come back. Kids in Brazil are crawling over rubbish dumps looking for bits of plastic. They get paid whatever it is, a cent per kilogram. Right? You can put 10 cents on a bottle. There'll be no bottles lying in rubbish dumps anywhere. Right? Now, what's that do? It creates jobs. It creates opportunities for recycling. It creates closing of the loop. So if we design the economy in that way and it's renewably powered, right, and plastics come from waste products being recycled as opposed to from oil out of the ground, yes, there's enough resources. So we've just got to decide that we want to do that.
Hi, I think you just kind of answered my question, but I was just wanting to, I have this ongoing debate with my father about economics, and I'm a real passionate about buying less stuff. And his comeback with me is always about unemployment the death of industries, and so what happens to all those extra people that lose their jobs as a result of us buying less?
Yeah, no, great. And I've obviously had that argument with a few people over the years. And yes, that's right. If we all buy less stuff, this model of economic growth will be affected by that. That's the point. Right? If we keep on buying more and more stuff, the global economy will collapse and we'll be out of jobs anyway. And this is the essence of the problem, is the current model doesn't work. The current model is driving unemployment. The current model is driving inequality. The current model is driving economic instability. Right? And that will lead, if we don't change, to collapse. Now, that is the problem of unemployment. So the idea that we can, you know, look, it'd be a lot more efficient for the economy right now in terms of job creation if we went back to slavery, right? Child labour, if we didn't have safety standards in our workplaces, if we could throw everything on the street rather than having to pick it up, that would actually be really good for the economy in the short term, and then it would fall apart and die. Right? Don't think he's listening to me. So that kind of idea, I mean, those, and this is the conversation I have with business people, it's an economic question. Right? It's an economic question. This current economic model is failing economically. Right, and therefore, if we can wait till the crisis comes, it collapses, and then we have massive unemployment, social instability, political conflict, and the one the business people hate, so I say it a lot, and a rise of nationalistic governments that will apply protectionism, right, and control the economy, and they all panic at that point, right, because that's what will happen, right? If you have a global system falling apart, then you'll get, you know, the UKIP in the UK, nationalism, National Front in France. They're the political parties that will rise, and they're very anti-market and anti-corporate, which is very convenient for my argument. That is the argument. And so I think you make the argument economically. We either decide to change ahead of time and manage it in a way which is fair and just for the workers that need to transition into new industries, or we wait till it all falls apart and then panic, right, and have political instability and chaos. That's the economic choice. And there are many people who argue this purely from an economic point of view. So Jeremy Grantham, a big US investor, manages a $100 billion investment fund, writes about the collapse of the global economy, right, as a threat that we face. And so there are many ways of arguing that purely from an economic point of view. Yeah.
Thanks so much. Greg Hunt from the South East Council's Climate Change Alliance. We spend a fair bit of time angsting over trying to, you know, lobby politicians and do our kind of stuff. From the sounds of it, your view might be that the market's going to be driving this anyway. What's the role for the political leadership, and how much should we be spending our time and energy trying to do, you know, trying to interact with them?
Yeah. Look, I think it's a very it's a funny question, not the question, but there's a funny issue, right? Because it's the threat and the pressure of government action that is driving the transformation in the market that we're seeing. Right? Some cases there's actually regulation, like solar was driven by German government putting in feed-in tariffs that then drove Chinese production that then drives Australian and US installations. So there's a cycle there directly from policy. So policy is very important. But I guess the idea is waiting for them to lead is wrong. Rather, they're going to follow rather than lead in most cases. So the pressure should be applied there, but the short answer is less. Right, in terms of our available capacity, I would put a lot more energy into driving change on the ground, supporting people who are doing things like solar, you know, etc., and less time on worrying about policy when policy makers aren't listening, which is the case today, right, in most countries. So I think that's it's an opportunity, kind of knocks when it's there, grab hold of it, but don't push against the closed door too long, because that takes energy away from other things. And it's also not empowering. It's also this, you know, I call my analysis in terms of political strategies, a strategy of inevitability, arguing inevitability. We are going to change. So people say, no, we're not. Okay, fine, you'll find out. Keep investing in coal. How's that going for you? You know, very badly. But you go right ahead. I don't mind if you lose your money. Right. So that strategy of inevitability, that change is going to come. And so in the case of Australia, the argument for the coal industry, for example, is that we're losing jobs massively in coal today. Not because of some environmentalist war on coal, right? Although that's going pretty well, actually. But because the market is making it go that way. And that the issue there I worry about is the loss of jobs in those regions. Are we managing that transition well? Are we going to leave behind a bitter and angry, you know, group in the community who blame other people for it, etc.? Might sound familiar for some local people. That transition is the issue, but inevitability is the outcome.